Today we're talking about Secretary of Health and Human Services Alex Azar, one of the busiest men in America. He's been tasked with quickly and efficiently reuniting families, as well as negotiating down drug prices. And I thought I was gonna have to wait till the 27th to see Mission Impossible. Anyways, there's definitely going to be a part 2 for this guy, which is more than I could say for Ben Carson, whose biggest accomplishment so far has been perfecting the art of sleeping with his eyes open. So, for this first part, we're talking about family reunification. Now, first off, Secretary Azar is a hard guy to have sympathy for sometimes, considering he goes on TV and says things like, "We're performing a great act of generosity and charity for migrant children." You know, the same kind of generosity and charity that occasionally gets confused for a human rights abuse by the UN. I mean, Secretary Azar, what is the plan here? Maybe I can get in front of the story if I just go on the news after months of bad publicity and say we're doing good things. That'll win the people over. The problem is that his critics are conflating two different issues. The separation and the custody.
And did you yourself work with the administration on this executive order?
We get the children once they're unaccompanied and take care of them. So immigration policy isn't really what we at HHS do. That would be the Department of Homeland Security working with DOJ and the White House.
Man, you have to lead with that. You're not the guy in charge of splitting up the families. You're the one who's in charge of unifying families, feeding, sheltering, and protecting children. I mean, if you could stop having the smuggest look in the world, we might even classify you as the good guy in this story. Basically, you're like the church where babies get dropped off. Except, in this case, the government, in a period of a few months, pulled in and started giving you thousands of additional kids of all ages to take care of. Now, this is not a new problem either, because...
So the vast majority of the children that we have in the unaccompanied children program are these children who come into the country totally unaccompanied. So either the parents have sent them here or they have just come of their own volition to the U.S.
So even if we unify families, those facilities are going to stay open because the U.S. is currently playing house with 20,000 actual unaccompanied minor migrants that haven't been separated from their parents, but rather just showed up and can't be deported. Despite the fact that most of us are just hearing about these centers now for the first time, this problem is, well, it's legally old enough not to qualify as a minor anymore.
So what we do at HHS is we have an unaccompanied children program, and the Obama administration had it, the Bush administration before it, set up by statute.
Boy, do I feel old. Alright, so now to the news we're hearing about. Because over the past few months, children with families have been separated from their families and put into these centers. Because, legally speaking, children cannot be held in adult detention centers for more than 20 days. And guess who's tasked with the bureaucratic nightmare that is getting these families back together?
Behind closed doors, the Department of Health and Human Services is scrambling to reunite families separated at the border, sending 230 workers to speed things up.
This is an unprecedented situation.
Oh man, Secretary Azar, this sucks for you. You know who's laughing though? Ex-Trump HHS Secretary Tom Price, who got fired for, in a matter of months, spending over $1 million in taxpayer money on private flights around the world. He got to chill like a rich guy and not deal with any of this. So, Secretary Azar, what is going on with this new reunification push?
Today, HHS said it will meet a deadline to reunite migrant children younger than 5 years old with their families by Tuesday.
Wow, you know, I'm glad to hear that. I was beginning to lose hope.
Fox News alert, the federal government missing a court-ordered deadline to reunite migrant children under the age of 5 with their parents.
Well, that's just great. First, what is this court case? Well, it simply set two timelines for family reunifications. Reunify all parents with children who are under the age of 5 within 14 days, and all parents with their minor children within 30 days. Well, that sounds incredibly simple. What's the problem? Well, let's dive into the 94 under 5-year-olds who we failed to deliver. Well, 34 were definitely returned to their families, so we're hitting about a 36%. Hey, that's a solid F. 12 of those kids had their parents deported. Whoops. 17 parents are still in vetting, which includes a Maury Povich, you're the real father test, as well as a background check to make sure everything is safe. 10 can't be reunited because their families are in criminal custody, and raising a child in jail might actually be worse than a detention center. 16 won't be returned because their parents are deemed to be a legitimate risk to the child's health. And I'm not talking about small things.
The remaining ones are children whose parents didn't confirm to be parents. They were lying about being parents. They're demonstrably unfit. We've got one alleged to be a murderer, one who's a kidnapper, one rapist, one who's a trafficker, one alleged by the child to be a child abuser.
Although one of those is just sick with an infectious disease and will be reunited once she gets over that. 4 have been released to family members, and 1 has yet to have their family identified. So this is one heck of a mess. Especially when you scale that up to the approximately 2,900 kids we have to reunite with parents by July 26th. I say approximately because we're really winging it. I mean, we're pretty sure it's less than 3,000 kids, but apparently the administration couldn't spring for a data entry intern, so we're making like jazz and just improvising as things go along. Just listen to Azar confidently answer questions on family reunification numbers.
Many have been reunified.
So they would be unified with either parents or other relatives.
How many of them have been reunified?
Well, that's exactly what I'm saying. They have been placed with a parent or other relative.
I am really trying to give you a fair shake, but my God, man, can you even try to be a little less punchable? So it's clear, we're not going to make that deadline because we're lacking truly basic knowledge. Like, how many families do we need to reunify? That's like the first question. So you want to reunify families? How many? Despite that setback and missing this court case's deadline, this court case seems to have lit a fire under the bureaucracy's collective butt, and it seems as though we are going to brute force our way through and unite as many families as we legally can. So, before I move on to the final topic, I want to throw another bone to Secretary Azar and say that this data problem was based on the Department of Justice lying about every separated child's case file having been marked, which was not the case. Because it would require one iota of foresight to think, I'm gonna separate kids from their parents and mix them in with parentless kids. Well, might see no point in taking the 2 seconds to indicate that they have a family. And list their parents' names on the document? That wouldn't be helpful. Although, when you're tearing a kid from his parents, it isn't the ideal time to hand them a questionnaire. Seriously, what are we doing? Alright, so one final question. What is happening to these unified families? The legal issue that triggered this family separation was, children cannot stay in detention facilities for longer than 20 days based on limits set in the 1997 Florida Settlement Agreement. This means that kids can't stay in adult detention facilities. Well, recently an LA judge refused to extend that 20 days to allow for families to be held together in detention centers, in what might be the one time when it's actually in the best interests of human rights to allow kids to be held in federal custody. Or, of course, we could stop detaining every illegal until their asylum court case like we've done for decades. But, you know. So seriously, what are we gonna do? We can only keep kids in adult federal custody for 20 days. And we want to keep the families together. Well, there's no one answer right now, but what Republicans are pushing for, not Trump, but Republicans, is a GOP measure from Senator Ted Cruz would increase the number of immigration judges from roughly 375 to 750. The basic idea is here is that we would just load the border with judges and just try to hammer out whether a family gets asylum here or not in 20 days or less. This would clear up a ton of problems, but as you can imagine, it has its objectors. Including the president.
He fired off on Twitter, ignoring existing legal rights for undocumented immigrants. We must immediately, with no judges or court cases, bring them back from where they came. The president's edict fails to recognize constitutional due process, long-established case law that grants that protection to non-citizens.
Great. Yeah, he's against hiring new judges because he wants to work at a system of extrajudicially expelling immigrants. To make sure he was actually constitutionally wrong, because come on, that was NBC, and if you're running episodes of news in between episodes of America's Got Talent, I'm gonna have to fact check some of your claims. I looked it up, and yes, he is wrong under the 14th Amendment because of the Supreme Court case of Zedvaidas versus David said the due process of the 14th Amendment applies to all aliens in the United States whose presence may be or is unlawful, involuntary, or transitory. So hopefully I won't be talking about this in next season's Supreme Court Saturday, but with Trump, who knows? For the meantime, that's what's going on with Alex Azar and his family reunification attempts. Tune in to next You're Hired for part two.
So the president has promised that he's going to put American patients first and drive down the prescription drug costs in the United States. And what he's going to be laying out this afternoon will be the most comprehensive plan to attack prescription drug price affordability of any president in history.
And wow, that sounds important and 100% true. Well, we'll see if he's telling the truth next time. And as always, thank you for watching. Hey YouTube, if you want to support independent journalism investigating Trump's cabinet, subscribe to our YouTube channel for our weekly episodes. As always, thank you for watching.